Thank you, Worship Team. A beautiful song. A very befitting song for today's sermon. Now, in the last two Sundays, our associate lay leader, Gilbert Locke, preached on service, God's people. And last Sunday, Preacher Wendy preached on service, the shape of Christ-centered followers. Both are along the theme of service for this month of October. And I believe they quoted something from Lord of the Rings, and that movie was made into a trilogy. So I don't have any quotation, but I'm going to make a trilogy of our sermon. Our sermon topic for this morning is service, called to servanthood. Our scripture text for today is taken from the book of John, chapter 13, verse 4 and 5, and of the same chapter from verse 14 and 15. So please read together with me. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. This is the word of God. From the scripture verse, or the verses, one of the central actions involved is that of feet washing. Let's take a look at the significance and the culture of feet washing during Jesus' time. Roads in those days were dirty. It's not like our roads, obviously, yeah? They were dirty. There were animals' droppings everywhere, food waste, and even human waste. And I can attest to that because when I went desert camping a few times, pitch dark, you do your business. So those were the situation, the environment during those days. Roads dirty, animals droppings, humans waste, food waste everywhere. And travelers, when they move from point A to point B, from town to town, and when they come upon somebody's house, their feet need to be washed. And somebody need to do that washing. Guess who would be doing the washing? The slaves. If they don't have slaves, then the servants. There are many kinds of servants. They have different duties, different chores to do around the household. But servants must be of the lowest grade. In a household, if there are slaves, and there are two kinds of slaves, Hebrew slaves and Gentile slaves, they even make that distinction who to wash the feet, the Gentile slaves. So every time a guest goes into somebody's house, the slaves must wash their feet. That's the hospitality extended to guests. That was the custom, the culture. John the Baptist went around proclaiming Christ. And he has this to say of Jesus. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. From John chapter 1, verse 27. Now remember this, John was a prophet. He was a great teacher. he has his own disciples. Everywhere he goes or he went, the disciples were mesmerized by his teaching. He has very good interaction with his audience. He was very well respected. So as great as he is, he says he's not worthy to untie the sandals of Jesus Christ. The ministry of Jesus Christ extended for about 3 years or slightly more. And as we are familiar with the sermon verses, when Jesus gathered his disciples for the Last Supper, the disciples were quarreling, arguing, debating among themselves who is the greatest. Now, as it is the custom, somebody needs to wash their feet. But nobody talk about it. They only care for themselves, who is the greatest. And the disciples probably, it's not mentioned anywhere in the Bible, but the disciples probably think that somebody will do it. It's a matter of process, you know, it's a matter of course. Somebody will do it. Every one of the disciples saw themselves as disciples and not servants or slaves. None wanted to be the lowest in the pecking order. It's very natural. They don't want to be the lowest. And here comes Jesus, out of the blue, if you want to call that, took his towel, a pail of water, and goes around washing the disciples' feet. From the time of John proclaiming the coming Messiah, saying that he's unworthy to untie the sandals of Jesus Christ. And now, Jesus, who himself has stood so low to wash his disciples' feet, there's now a paradigm shift. A shift to servanthood. Now, most of us are mediocre, average. One of my favorite phrases is, we, average, we are either the worst of the best or the best of the worst. We are just somewhere stuck in the middle. But we continue to be happy about it. We don't mind not to be the greatest. We don't have to be right at the top of the ladder. Just stay where we are. Be comfortable. Middle zone, average. So we never excel to be the greatest in sports, in music, in arts, in education, literature, technology, although some aspire with the practice on handphone, they are really good at that. But that's yet to come. They're still not the greatest. So though we know that, we don't want to be the last, the least, or the worst. To us, we want to be contented. Why? Very much so in our Asian culture, we don't want to lose face. We don't want events or things to hurt our pride. And we don't want our ego to be hurt because we are the last, we are the least, we are the worst. But Jesus redefined greatness. He's the greatest. Yeah, there's no denying that. He's the greatest. He's the Lord and teacher, and yet a servant to all. He said, I have set you an example, and you should do as I have done for you. The paradigm shifted again. From being unworthy, as mentioned by John, to the very action of Jesus washing the disciples' feet, the shift now is in fact not being unworthy or anything like that, but the paradigm shift has now shifted to a command from the Lord Jesus Christ. We call him our Lord and teacher. It is now a command. we are now worthy to be his servant. So what does this say to us today? When we follow Jesus, I say when, not if, when we follow Jesus, we need to change our lives, our attitudes. We must do something about ourselves. We cannot be changed on the inside. It has to flow outwards and impact others. That is the litmus test, a test of your service, the quality of your service to Christ. Now, I like to define quality here. It's not whether your service is good or bad, but it's the quality of your attitude towards servanthood. You need to take that very first step. The service is no longer talking about your position or your status. We serve without any intention to be seen. To be seen, huh? Not S-I-N, S-E-E-N. Often our service is mundane, low-key, unseen in the background, doing the small things, but yet things that needs to be done. True service remains contented. Contented to be in the background getting things done, and even when that service is being called upon and is being focused, we give glory to God. True service does not seek the limelight. It is living out of a new center of reference, the servanthood character of Christ. For us, as long as the divine nod of approval is given, it is sufficient for us. So Jesus said, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. And I make reference to the Song of Preparation, the Servant King. It's very befitting, this verse. I'll tell you a life experience. Sometime after the year 2006, and remember the NKF saga, National Kidney Foundation, that golden tap fiasco. Now, our cell group, together with other cell groups of AMC, we volunteered to help out in the Methodist Welfare Society flag donation day. We came to church, we collected our that plastic bag, and we set off to a predetermined destination, Jurong East MRT station. So we got in there, full of ego. To get go, we went into the MRT station, and within 2 or 3 minutes, the MRT staff descended upon us and says, ladies, gentlemen, you are not allowed to collect donations inside the MRT. It's the regulations. So, fine. We went out of the MRT stations. We positioned ourselves at all the entrances of the MRT. The same staff came to us and says, not even within these areas, you have to be outside the MRT premises totally. So things was going through my mind that if we don't obey, and if they call in the law, and then the newspaper will say, cell group in cells. Not very nice. So we went to Jurong East Shopping Center. I cannot remember how many floors there are, but we distribute ourselves, disperse ourselves to that, say, three floors. Then our phone ring. One of our buddies will say, "Hey, security guard coming after us. They say we cannot collect donations here." What happened for the next 2 or 3 hours was a cat and mouse game. The cat is on the third floor. The mouse ran down to the second floor. The cat is on the first floor. The mouse ran up to the third floor. It was going on like that, very, very frustrating. To an extent that we say we are not going to do our job very well. We congregate together, and then we say, "How much have you collected?" When I shake my bag, you can hear a lot of tinkling. That is no good, nah? That means a few coins only. Then I took my wife's bag and shake it. Solid, man. Heavy. Yeah. So I say, okay, behind every successful man, there must be a woman. I say, "Dear, you're doing very well. You give me your bag, you take my bag." So we went off again. We went off. But as much as I tried, at the escalator, at the entrances, 2 meters away, when I approach a potential donors, 2 meters away, we are like 2 north poles of a magnet. I did not move. He or she moved. No, they don't want to come near me. Okay, I can only speak for myself. My wife, I think, is doing better. They don't want to come near me. And on that day, I received quite a number of verbal abuse. I'm allergic to violence, so this is verbal abuse. Some of them will say, "Are you from NKF? Are you from another charity? I don't believe in charity anymore." It was really sad, really sad. But as hard as it is, I persevere, I move on. And I was telling myself, that coins in my bag, now I'm holding my wife's bag, I'm praying for her then. As much coins as there is in the bag, all I need to do is just put a $50 or $100 in that bag, and that finished the whole incident, right? But that's not the point. I need a physical action. So we did. We continued. So on that day, it exposed a lot of my inadequacy, insufficiency, worthless as it is, but my worth is in the servanthood of Christ. Our worth on that day is in the servanthood of Christ. So the lessons learned from that experience, service in the spirit of Jesus is not about self-centeredness. It is a life surrendered to the will of God, to the needs of our fellow man, and to the example of Christ. That MWS donation drive is no longer about me. My pride, forget about it. My ego was hurt, forget about it. I lost my face that day. If it had not been a concrete floor, I would bury my head in there like an ostrich. So what can we do for us individually and collectively? The many activities of the church ministry, social and outreach concern, worship and music, disciple nurture, you name it, it's all out there. Are you involved? Are you prepared to participate in them? Look at your bulletin. Almost every week, there's a call for some volunteers. I believe today, there's a call for help to be projectionists in the worship music ministries. Somewhere, there's always something calling out for you. And then there's this thing called a ministry of listening. If all this that I mentioned is too physical for you, too strenuous for you. This ministry of listening, it appears to be a passive ministry, but be available. There are people out there, there are friends out there who are troubled at work, who have problems at work and in their families, in their social life. The only elements that is required of you is be available, have a heart of compassion and patience. You don't need to have the correct answers for them all the time. Just be there to listen. Speech becomes truthful and honest at the appropriate time. Spend time with those who have few friends. After service, talk to those who you have not met. Ask them to have fellowship in your PCG, to have tea over service. Just get involved. Learn to bear one another's sorrow. As James called it, the law of love is the law of Christ. It's the law that is the royal law. True service builds community. It goes quietly, caring for the needs of others. It binds, it heals, and builds each other up in Christ. It is to follow Christ is something that you do not from the inside. It has to extend beyond yourself. You have to reach out. It's no longer spiritual knowledge, but it is action time. It is not about position. So you remember about the exercise I went through collecting donations. At that time, I thought it was me, a manager in management, going around asking for money. It's not about position or your status. It's about your attitude towards servanthood. So remember, we are not to be served, but to serve. As sad as it may be, some of us don't even know that we have been served. We thought it's a process. It's a natural thing, like feet washing. Somebody will come along to do it, but it's not. That's a beautiful cross. I did not draw it. I picked it up from internet, obviously. That's a beautiful cross. If you were to ask to draw a cross, what is the shape of your cross? A cross like this is still a cross. It may be ugly as it is, not as beautiful as the previous one, but it's still a cross. We can be reminded of the red vertical bar. We have listened to some other sermons. That red vertical bar is our relationship with God. We worship Him, we glorify Him, we adore Him. We thank Christ for dying on the cross, taking our sins and atoning for us. But we need to look at the horizontal bar. It is our relationship with our fellow men, our brothers and sisters, with the community. Christ wants us to stain our tower, our satin white tower, to be grayish, to be yellowish, to be rustic in color. Towers that are used many times over. How about this cross? I call it the radical cross. It's not how nice your cross is, it's how deep and wide your cross is. That horizontal bar is going to mean a lot of difference. That's what Jesus wants. Reaching out, touching lives. What is the shape of your cross? As we come to the close of this sermon, let's be reminded of changing our mindset. It is never too lowly of anyone to serve. As long as we get the divine nod of approval, we are on the right track. Serving is not about function. Okay. Serving is about function. Serving is about function. It is not about position or title. I deliberately say serving is not about function, just to make sure we are awake. Serving is indeed about function. It is hands-on. It got nothing to do with our position or title or status. The challenge for us, we are dealing with actions, not merely a state of mind. We cross over from our spiritual realm, inner knowledge, to one that is external. We must not only be educated. I did not say we must not be educated. I say we must not only be educated, but we must be activated, hands-on. The world looks upon us Christians to be exemplary in our conduct, one which is modeled after Christ in servanthood. The book of James says, "What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead." Every time I come across this verse, it's a very frightening verse for me. Especially when it comes to Sunday, coming to church, doing the worship, listening to sermon, professing our faith, and then I go home doing my own selfish things. I have no deeds. It's a very frightening verse. We don't want to be that. Putting into action. Again, look at your church bulletin, the call for volunteers in various many ministries. Approach one who is already involved in the existing ministries. They will guide you. They will hold your hands. They will give you proper training. Never, ever think that you're inadequate. The ball is in your court. It is up to you to participate. After service, invite people to your PCG group. Spend time with those who are alone. We say, Jesus is our Lord and teacher. He commanded us to serve through his example. Are we then putting that into action? Last but not least, is your cross befitting our Lord Jesus Christ? Do we hear him say, "Good and faithful servant"? What is the shape of your cross? Let us pray. Lord, you have taught us well in matters of the heart and mind. Are we truly your servants? We sincerely need the Holy Spirit to search and seek our hearts. Does it matter to you, Lord, if we be your servants in heaven, but not your call to servanthood during our time on earth? Have we lived a life that is truly lived, carrying out the work of a servant with a towel wrapped around our waist, just like our Lord Jesus Christ? Where we are failing you, forgive us and help us. Where we are lacking, empower, provide, and lead us to do your kingdom work. Give us a heart of flesh, filled with love and compassion. For your sake and glory, In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.